thank you very much. I want to take a quick moment just to say a few remarks to all of you. This has been a fantastic week for the HIMSS staff anyway, and I hope it has been for you as well. We've done a lot of things this week, had a lot of fun, got a little wet last night, but I hope it was good for you and that you've had a rewarding, educational, and entertaining week. So my appreciation for all of you being here. So let's move on and talk with these gentlemen and see what's going on in the world of politics and current events. And but let's start out in healthcare. And let's kind of go back in time a little bit. 2000, we're talking backstage, 2009-10 discussion around Accountable Care Act.
From both Affordable Care Act.
Affordable.
Yeah, it wasn't accountable.
It's a lot easier to call it Obamacare. Everybody knows what it is.
Affordable Care Act. What did the Democrats do right? What'd they do wrong? What'd the Republicans do right? What'd they do wrong that ended up in that piece of legislation?
Well, what they did right was make an attempt to offer affordable health insurance to all Americans. What they did wrong was trying to force people into a system that some people just didn't want to belong to. And then in terms of how they legislated it, they made the fatal mistake of shoving it through on a one-party vote. Big things in America that are lasting happen on a bipartisan basis. And so those were the pluses and minuses of what happened. And I'm sure we'll have a chance to talk more this morning about where we're going from here.
We might. So, Governor, from a state perspective, you looked at it differently. You saw perhaps a different perspective. You come from a different side of the aisle.
I thought there were two goals, and that was to increase accessibility and affordability. And I think we certainly succeeded in the first instance. Before Obamacare, there were 48 million Americans without health care coverage. There are now 28 million Americans without health care coverage. That's 20 million people. That's an enormous amount of people to get additional coverage. We're down to 8.9% uninsured in our population, the lowest we've ever been. So I think they succeeded in that regard. Where they failed, I mean, and I'm leaving aside the computer glitches and things like that, where they failed is on the affordability side of the equation. There wasn't enough emphasis and mandates for cost cutting that there should have been. It didn't include some of the technological advances. I mean, for example, we're here to people who use the information system to do things like telehealth. I'm the president of the board of Jefferson University Health System, and we use telehealth throughout the state of Pennsylvania, particularly useful for small counties. Many small counties in Pennsylvania have lost their primary care physician. And we tried to deal with that by increasing the scope of practice for nurse practitioners, but telehealth has been an enormous help in doing that. There's some pilots for medical homes, but medical homes are a far better and more cost-effective way to treat patients that wasn't mandated. They left a lot of things off the table on things that would reduce the cost of our healthcare delivery system. What the Republicans did wrong, and again, it's always who struck John, is not trying to work harder to reach consensus. There was that group that started off with Senator Grassley that I thought was going to really try to do some things together, and it broke apart. Whose fault that is, we could talk for a long time. But the remedy now is easy. We should get rid of Obamacare and keep the Affordable Care Act.
We'll get to the conversation of repeal and replace, but I want to come.
But you have to understand, it's quite an accomplishment to get every Republican in the House and Senate to vote no. Even a greater accomplishment to ever get them to vote yes.
I think we're working on that, aren't we? Take us back, though. You were in the House, and you had to have been part of some conversations, and at some point it broke down.
None.
How did it play out?
None. On the House side, we were never invited to a conversation, never invited into a room. And I understand what happened. The Senate passed this with 60 Democrat senators. And after it passed the Senate on Christmas Eve in 2011, Ted Kennedy passed away, and the bill had not passed the House. And so when it came over to the House, if they had changed anything in the bill, they would have to go back to the Senate. They didn't have 60 votes. And so they knew they had a flawed piece of legislation to begin with, and they had no choice in their minds but to go ahead and just pass it.
Pass it. So play it on out over the next couple of years. A premise that I have is that the Democrats just didn't feel that they had a position to reopen the discussion to fix it. Because normally with you guys, yeah, you pass something and then you have to come back. You right. learn some things and you fine tune it. We never had that opportunity over the next 6-7 years.
No, but because we had been closed out of the initial conversations, we didn't have our fingerprints on this. And the problems weren't our problems. And if they would have opened the door, we would have worked with them to fix some of the problems they wanted to fix, but we would have wanted to make some changes as well. But they had no interest in the changes that we were willing to offer.
Yeah. So now let's come forward. The Republicans' fingerprints are going to be all over what's next.
All over.
Yeah. So couple of things to sort of talk about, and then I also want the state perspective in terms of Medicaid expansion and the related issues to this. Are the Republicans going to do it any differently than the Democrats did?
I don't know. I think that's going to be a work in progress. But most of the Affordable Care Act, in the framework is going to stay there. You know, coverage for kids up to age 26, covering those with pre-existing conditions, all of that's going to be there. Subsidies for those who can't afford it, who aren't on Medicaid, but what I'll call the working poor, subsidies for them will be there. But what will be different is that a CMS will not dictate to every single state exactly how the plan's going to run. And if the state wants to run an exchange, the state can run an exchange. The states will control the policies that are offered like they control every other insurance product offered in their states. And so this is not all that hard to figure out, except this. In the 25 years that I served in the United States Congress, Republicans never, ever, one time agreed on what a health care proposal should look like, not once. And all this happy talk that went on in November and December and January about repeal, 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 yeah, we'll do replace, replace, I started laughing because if you pass repeal without replace, first, anything that happens is your fault. You broke it. And secondly, as I told some of the Republican leaders when they asked, I said, if you pass repeal without replace, you'll never pass replace because they will never, ever agree on what the bill should be. Perfect always becomes the enemy of the good. Mm-hmm. And so you've got to marry them together. It's the only chance we'll have to get it done. That's why it's taken a lot longer than people had anticipated.
Governor?
Well, I think John's definitely right, but there are three really Republican perspectives. There's the president who wants to keep everybody covered and in some cases increase the quality of the product. There are the Senate Republicans who are a little bit more cautious about repealing. And then there's the House, and John knows the House, of course, better than anybody, where I think they're going to be, if the House has its way, a significant reduction in services. Because understand, if you get rid of all of the taxes, which is the plan, if you roll Medicaid eligibility back to the pre-ACA levels, percentage of poverty, that's going to mean one thing. Number one, without the taxes and without the mandate, and they're going to get rid of the mandate too, you can't ask providers to have any sort of health care offering because there's no way the providers will be able to make money or even break even. There's got to be something, some way to pay for the subsidies. And we've already seen a little bit of this. Unbeknownst, this wasn't covered very much by the press. The president signed an executive order which did two basic things. One, it reduced the enrollment period from 12 months to 6 months, an attempt to tamp down the number of people who continue to join the ACA. And secondly, it reduced the services covered by all the metal plans, the silver, the platinum, the gold, et cetera. And what that means is that about $9 billion of savings are going to be achieved by doing this, but it's going to mean that people are going to have to pay more for what they're getting right now. So it's very, very hard to do. It's going to take some time. And the only way we're going to do this, and sometimes I think it's possible, but without someone like John in the House, I'm not sure it is possible. We're going to have to get together, put all the political rhetoric aside, and try to figure out what we need to get rid of in the ACA, what we need to keep, how we can improve it, and work on it like we worked on things that we did in a nonpartisan fashion. And you're right, Social Security Act has been amended how many times since it passed? Time after time after time. So I think repealing doesn't make any sense because you need the mandate or taxes or some way of paying for what you're asking the providers to offer. And it just doesn't work without it. It's almost impossible to have a guarantee that if you're sick, you won't lose your, you won't be denied coverage without having healthy people in the pool. So, I mean, I think the two ways to fix it most of all is I would put a public option in the exchange. I think we should have done that at the beginning. That will enhance competition. And the most successful part of the ACA has been the Medicaid expansion. And by the way, if your governor hasn't expanded and the House bill passes, those states won't have a chance to expand Medicaid. And so that's number one. I'd put a public option in. And two, I'd have a whole lot more emphasis on affordability. And that includes negotiating the ability of the government to negotiate with drug companies. That bill is up. That bill comes up every year. And this isn't a Republican problem. It's a Republican and Democratic problem. People vote against a bill that makes abundant sense, a power that the Veterans Administration has. And why do they vote against it? Because who gives the greatest money to candidates running for office on both sides of the equation? Who pays for the most lobbyists? And that's a simple change, and it would do wonders for the affordability of the system.
At the cost of new drugs. You know, there's a reason why all the innovation in pharmaceuticals happens, virtually all of it happens in the United States. Because in the United States, you actually have an opportunity to develop a new drug, a new therapy, and to be paid for it. You know, and the rest of the world kind of gets off, they get off cheap because we do the development here, we do the innovation here, and then they get to copy it. And so it's, when you start talking about controlling drug prices, which is basically what some of my colleagues across the aisle want to do, it comes with another sharp edge on the other side of that sword. And if you could figure out where the right balance is, then you might have something, but I've not quite ever seen the right balance. And I don't want to shut off the innovation machine that the pharmaceutical industry brings to the United States.
Yeah,
and then we want to move on, but I think John's right about that point. But the government gives an awful lot of money to research in its own right, number one. And number two, if I were president, something that I never aspired to be, and I would like to say that I'm too old now, but who knows, given...
No, you're not too old, Ed.
But if I were president, the first thing I would do is I would go to the WTO, the World Trade Organization, and file complaints against every country in the world that price fixes their drugs, because they're getting a free ride on our back. And it is, to me, a violation of the WTO. And we should make everyone pay for research, because research is the key and they get the benefit of it.
Governor, you mentioned Medicaid expansion. I think in most state budgets, Medicaid's probably the biggest item that faces governors and state legislators in terms of solving their financial issues, except maybe in Illinois where it's pensions. But anyway, that's a different story. Is it good policy? Is it the ticking time bomb for state budgets because the feds will change the rules downstream and make the states pick up more than this first offer?
Well,
what are your views on that?
That's the problem. Medicaid before the ACA, there was a formula, but basically it was 50-50. The states paid half, the federal government paid half. That varied state from state. But under the ACA, for the first 3 years, the states paid nothing. And then for the succeeding 5 or 6 or 7 years, it was a 90-10 ratio. So it was a no-brainer for the states. The only governors who didn't take it were governors who wanted to make a political statement. But a lot of governors did, and a lot of good Republican governors took the expansion. The problem is, when that time runs out, or actually in the bill that Speaker Ryan's working on, they roll that back to the old formula of 50-50. Then it's going to hit the states extraordinarily hard.
I don't expect that you're going to see any contraction in the number of Medicaid patients that are covered. What I do think you're going to see is rather than Medicaid being run out of D.C. by D.C. for the D.C. bureaucrats, you're going to see states have more flexibility in terms of how they cover their Medicaid populations. You know, there's a program in your state. No, it's in Baltimore. It's in Maryland. I think it's at Johns Hopkins, where they have 630,000 Medicaid patients that they get paid a per capita rate by the state of Maryland. It's a test with the U.S. government, and they get a flat rate. And so it's in their interest to help keep those patients healthy, keep them out of acute situations, and showing some big results. And so I think you're going to see not less coverage, but more flexibility given to the states in terms of how they deal with those populations.
Well, there's no question John's right. We ought to be experimenting on things. And the ACA did give, for example, some grant money for states who wanted to use the medical home concept to keep chronic care patients out of the hospital and to keep them as well as can be. And we should be doing all that stuff. But having been in state and local government for 20, 25 years, I can tell you when Washington, I don't mean necessarily John, but when Washington says, we're going to give you greater flexibility, that's a code word for we're giving you less money.
Having been a state legislator for a short time in my career, nothing would irritate me more than the federal government laying out this big pot of money and then putting every string in the world on it. And so you have to do X, Y, or Z, or you don't get the money. And so this relationship between the states and the federal government, I think, is going to change, not dramatically, but it's going to change here over this next presidential term, where, all right, here's the money, but here's the goal. Here are some broad outlines of what you can and can't do. But the states are going to have more flexibility over how they use not just Medicaid funds, but some other federal programs.
Over the past 10 or 15 years, HIMSS has been on the Hill a lot. We were in your office a lot talking about information technology, and it was always an easy question. It wasn't a political question. We seem to feel, at least from our outside perspective, that there was a common thought that technology is one of those ways we're going to solve some of the big problems in healthcare. Is that true? Were we hearing the right things?
No, absolutely true. I mean, I worked with then Chairman Paul Ryan when he was in the Ways and Means Committee. Mike Burgess, who's over at the Health Subcommittee at Energy and Commerce, Dr. Burgess, heavily involved in this, as is Greg Walden, and the new chairman of the Ways and Means Committee from Texas. I mean, they're all committed to more health IT because they frankly see better outcomes for the American people. But the question is, how do you narrow this down into something that's effective? Mm-hmm. You know, we've got people come to see me and my colleagues every day with every great idea in the world, and they all want the same thing, including the governors, more money. And so it's not like the federal government doesn't spend a lot of money, but at some point you've got to narrow this down into making decisions about what's effective and what isn't. To the extent that you all come with better ideas, more efficient ideas, much better shot at getting the money you need to begin to build the infrastructure you're looking for.
Governor, backstage, we were talking about Pennsylvania and especially rural Pennsylvania, and you were commenting on how technology is making certain things possible.
Absolutely. Again, many counties in Pennsylvania don't even have a primary care physician anymore, but the nurse practitioner sits down with the patient, gets on the internet, speaks to a doctor in Pittsburgh or Philadelphia or Harrisburg, and in most cases, that's a good treatment modality. You know, what John said is undoubtedly right, but if we're going to have a true information healthcare system using technology to its fullest extent, we have to pay to lay the infrastructure. There's no question. And the medical community can pay so much, but states and the federal government ought to participate in that. And John says, well, we're always asking for money. Well, that's true, but sometimes you spend money to save money. So for example, if you're in a big building and you've got an antiquated energy system, you may have to spend X amount of dollars to buy a new, of capital dollars, to buy a new system, but that system saves you so much on a yearly basis that in 3 or 4 years you've made back your initial expenditure. That's what I would analogize the needs of the of having a truly national information technology system that helps us cut costs and improve quality of care. We're going to spend money up front to save money year after year after year after year. And as the internet gets more and more able to do more and more things, I think it's going to be remarkable what we're going to be able to use technology to do in the system. So that's when I got the invitation. I was so happy to come down here, that and the fact that you're paying us.
I'm just happy to be here. We're a couple of has-beens. All we are now are celebrities.
And we're so happy to have you with us. I actually had a chance this week to talk with some folks from Cleveland area, Bioenterprises. Really a emerging hub in the Cleveland area in terms of bio and medical innovation. Some interesting stuff going on there in terms of what that region is doing to try to attract talent to the region. You've got some great universities there that is producing a lot of talent. Very optimistic in terms of not only there, but around the country, the focus on innovation. You mentioned earlier about making sure we don't do things that stifle innovation.
No, there's a lot going on all over the country, and this, in my view, is kind of what makes America different than other countries, is that the 50 states, I call them 50 laboratories of democracy, because what one state will try, if a people see that it's working in other states, guess what? They'll copy it. And when you look at innovation, whether it's healthcare or other things, the more that it goes on around the country, the more that we learn, and you don't have it in one place. You don't have it just funded by the federal government. I mean, I think we do a very good job with NIH. I think the Cures Bill that passed last year will help NIH in a big way. But that's more on the basic, really basic research. But what comes out of there to the private sector could be immense. With all these technology and biotech hubs popping up all over the country.
Absolutely, yeah. All right, well, let's turn our attention to some other topics and things that are on people's minds. Go back to last summer or fall. When did you know who the next president was gonna be?
About 10:15 on election night.
How did everybody get it so wrong?
I told audiences all during the fall that I thought the chance that Hillary would win was 60-40. And then I would go on to tell them that, remind them that polls don't decide elections, voters do. And while these pollsters, I think they're pretty good at modeling who's gonna show up and who isn't gonna show up, they really don't know. And then I tell them a story, so I make it clear that, you know, Donald Trump can win. Then I told them a story about polling. My first race for Congress in 1990, I had a problem. The incumbent Republican was in trouble. He wasn't going to win, but his former congressman wanted to come back. You know, my name looks like Boehner, Bonner, Boehner. And if they can't say your name, they're not going to vote for you. Well, this former member of Congress who wanted to come back, his name was Tom Kindness.
Oh.
So you got Kindness versus Boehner, all right? And so we work hard for 6 months, raise this money. We take a poll. I'm losing by 82 points. And my staff lied to me for the next 8 months. Oh, it's getting better, it's getting better. It never got better. But I won the race because I turned out voters that they didn't think would ever show up and vote in a Republican primary. And when you look at what happened, Trump's people showed up in greater numbers than Hillary's people showed up, and that's why I won. Simple as that.
Yeah, I think that's probably right. But first of all, interestingly, the national polls weren't very wrong. Almost every national poll the Monday before the election had Secretary Clinton winning by 3 or 4 points. She wound up winning the popular vote by 2 points. So they weren't that wrong. Where they were wrong was in the state-by-state polls, and significantly wrong in some states. I said on the air, even from the Democratic convention, where we were ahead by 12 points in Pennsylvania, I said, Pennsylvania is not a given. There's a hidden Trump vote out there. People don't always tell pollsters the truth. We had a mayor in Philadelphia in the 70s by the name of Frank Rizzo. He was a former police commissioner, and he offended everybody, except ordinary people loved him. And when the pollsters called, they were afraid to admit they were voting for Frank Rizzo. Frank Rizzo polled on election day, did 5 points better than any poll in all the elections he ran in. And I said, the same effect is going to be there for Trump. And then you had variables happen, and there are variables in every election. Number one, what FBI Director Comey did 11 days out was a huge game changer. For example, in Pennsylvania, the poll the day before Comey went public with his announcement, Hillary Clinton was winning the 4 suburban Philadelphia counties that have more votes than the city put together, a lot more votes than the city. She was winning them by 22 points. On election day, she won by 11 points. Had she won by 22 points, she carries the state by 100,000 instead of losing by 45,000. So Comey was a variable that was hard to figure in, hard to pick up in the polls. The Clinton campaign made tons of mistakes. In Philadelphia, we had a greater turnout than we did for President Obama in 2012. But in Milwaukee and Detroit, they had a significantly reduced turnout. If they had the same turnout, she carries Wisconsin and Michigan. Well, why did they have a reduced turnout, and why did Philadelphia have a greater turnout? Because we got Hillary 5 times, President Obama 3 times, Bill Clinton 4 times, Joe Biden 5 times, Vice President candidate Kane 4 times, and Milwaukee and Detroit got virtually nothing. So there were bad mistakes made, and it was tough to figure all of that out. But I think the last 11 days with Boehner made it very difficult to poll.
Boehner.
You can't blame him for everything.
No. He was gone. He actually voted for Hillary. But he'll never tell you that, but he did.
That is not true. And you know it.
I'm going to step back here for a moment and let you two run with this.
There's exactly one Democrat in the entire country that Donald Trump could beat, and that was Hillary Clinton. And Hillary Clinton could only beat one Republican, possibly, Donald Trump. My God, we have 330 million Americans. How in the hell did we get ourselves in this spot? Ed and I, we've been around the block a few times in the political world, but all the norms are gone. All the bedrock principles of running campaigns and what you do and what you don't do is all thrown out the window. And so we're in for a pretty raucous ride. You know, I expect the Trump presidency is going to look a lot like the Trump campaign. Sometimes divisive, sometimes incoherent, sometimes disrespectful, but also sometimes effective. And I don't know why anybody would think that if you've watched his campaign for the last 12 months, well, why his presidency of the next 12 months is going to be much different. It's not. I have to tell you this. I got to tell you that Ed heard me tell the story, but Vice President Biden and I were at Notre Dame, University of Notre Dame last May. They gave us the Latari Medal, the biggest honor they give, and they gave it to the president, myself, Vice President, myself. And so it was at the commencement, and I told the students, I said, you know, Latari is a Latin word. In English, it means rejoice. Exactly what I've done every single day since I left.
Well, let me tell you in terms of what's going to happen. I think John's description was pretty accurate. I was on one of the shows, and the discussion was that Russia was now compiling a psychological profile on President Trump. And one of the panelists said, well, that's not unusual. They do that for every American president. And I said, yeah, that's true, but this is going to be the most unique psychological profile Russians ever took. I think the problem with saying that the Trump presidency is going to be like the Trump campaign, you can't govern exactly the way you campaign. You simply can't. You've got to value the institutions. To show you Donald Trump's great strength with his base, he said something that if any other president had said, there would have been immediate calls for his impeachment. I don't know how many of you saw the interview with Bill O'Reilly when Bill O'Reilly said to him, well, Putin's a killer. And President Trump said, well, you think we don't kill people? Putin killed journalists and he kills political opponents. To say that the United States does the same thing as the moral equivalent of the Russian government and the way Putin rules, it's insane. And it's a stunning statement. So you've got to be different than on the campaign trail. On the campaign trail, you can win with, as Donald Trump did, with 43, 44% of the voting American public. As president, you're supposed to govern for all of us. And I fear that the things that caused Donald Trump to act the way he does, he beat Hillary Clinton. Forget about Hillary Clinton. The easiest thing to be in politics is a gracious winner. Forget about Hillary Clinton. Forget about the size of your crowd at your inauguration. Nobody cares. Forget about the electoral vote you got, but if you're going to talk about it, at least have the facts in order. You know?
And he ought to forget about the press.
Absolutely.
You know, you were taught this just like I was. You never get into a pissing match with a skunk. You can't win.
That's right. And you also never get into a pissing match with somebody who has a printing press.
That's right.
Can't win that either.
The editor always has the last word.
Right.
35 years ago, we had a president we called the Teflon president. This guy seems to be able to say anything he wants and doesn't stick. What's changed? Or has it?
Well, I think a lot's changed the media in terms of how people get their information. You know, it used to be the three big networks, five big newspapers, and a big radio station. Pretty much that was the news. Today, with the internet and all these news sources and people choosing to get their news from wherever they want to get it, there's just a lot more news that's out there. And Trump tweeting, he's created his own phenomenon that nobody ever quite had seen or really knows what to do with, including his own staff. He did it in an odd way, a most unconventional campaign you ever saw, probably the most unconventional president we're going to see in our lifetimes. But just remember this, he's also going to be somewhat effective. He's going to do things that a normal politician like Ed or I, are you normal?
No. Definitely not.
He's going to do things that no traditional president would do, Democrat or Republican. You know, he's going to have an opportunity to do big things. Now, the key to his success, in my view, is not him tweeting or making noise. The key to his success is reaching to the leaders in the Congress. What he's going to find out pretty quickly is the presidents have very limited powers.
Right.
You know, at the end of the day, you have to change laws. You got to pass laws. And you don't do that in Washington without working with the leaders of both parties. The Congress is nothing more than a committee of 535 people. Has anybody ever seen a committee of 535 people accomplish anything? And so if you don't have the leaders helping pull people together, not much is really going to happen. And so I know he's bringing members down there, bringing the leaders down there. He just has to keep doing it.
What do you think, let's be positive here, what do you think will be the signature accomplishment? What's the thing that, on a positive note, that is likely to? So not what you wish, but as you look at it, look at the country, and it's like, yeah, he's going to solve this problem and we're gonna feel good about it.
Well, I think they'll fix Obamacare. I shouldn't have called it repeal and replace, because that's not what's gonna happen. They're basically gonna fix the flaws and put a more conservative box around it. They're gonna do some tax reform. We'll see how much reform gets done, but there's gonna be a big tax bill. But the signature item, if I had to throw a dart today, immigration reform. A big bipartisan immigration reform bill that we've worked on for years on the Hill. It's ready to go. Broadly bipartisan. We've got a huge problem because our system doesn't work. We can't track people. We don't know who's here. We don't know when they come. We don't know when they leave. It's a mess. And the fact is, we also have all these people here that are here without documents, who are going to stay here. We need them in our workforce. We need them in our country. And there's a way to legalize those people in a humane way that doesn't undercut the system and all the people who play by the rules under the current system. But I think that's the issue. And when we get up 4 years down the road, Donald Trump may be the immigrant's best friend.
Governor?
Are you all right?
I love you too, honey.
I think the easiest one, because it is inherently, and I think John will agree with this, inherently bipartisan, and it's desperately needed, and it's a big thing, and Donald Trump wants to do big things, would be a real infrastructure revitalization program. The American infrastructure is crumbling. In the year 2000, we were ranked by the World Economic Forum as having the best infrastructure in the world. Today, we're ranked 12th. We are falling apart. The American Society of Civil Engineers says we have to spend an additional $1.6 trillion on our infrastructure in the next 8 years just to get it up to where it should be at average quality level. The president talks about a $1 trillion program. He wants to do it all in tax credits. That won't happen in the Congress. And we can't do, the private sector can play a role in fixing our infrastructure, but the private sector wants a rate of return, obviously. That's why they're investing their money. Infrastructure tends to be a stable investment, but there has to be a rate of return. Take the bridges of the country. There are 70,000 structurally deficient bridges in America. And my guess is about 100 of them could be tolled. Tolling would be the rate of return that private sector investment would need. The other 69,900 are gonna need government investment. Now the states have stepped up and raised their gas tax, and raised their gas tax significantly. We need to generate more money in Washington to match what the states have done to rebuild our infrastructure. And the interesting thing is, it's not that tough. I'll give you an example, and you have to be honest and answer this question. How many of you know what the federal gas tax is per gallon? Raise your hand if you know what the federal gas tax is per gallon. Almost no one in a crowd of very intelligent people. It's 18.4 cents a gallon. It's so easy to raise it because nobody knows what it is to begin with. One of the best Republicans in the Senate is a senator from Tennessee by the name of Bob Corker. Terrific guy. Really, I admire him greatly. He sponsored a bill with Senator Murphy from Connecticut to raise the gas tax 10 cents a gallon and index it to inflation. People hearing that might have grumbled a little bit, but they would have forgotten about it. In Pennsylvania, the Republican governor, with me standing by his side urging Democrats to vote for it, we raised our gas tax 32 cents over 5 years, 32 cents a gallon. Not one Democrat or Republican who voted for it lost in the next election. And that was the main issue raised against them by either their Democratic opponent or their Republican opponent. So that book that I wrote, A Nation of Wusses, the biggest problem is no one wants to take a remotely risky vote. I had a conversation with Steve LaTourette, who recently passed away, a terrific Republican congressman from Ohio. And he told me, Governor, if it was a secret ballot, we'd have 400 votes in the House for raising the gas tax and 88 in the Senate. Well, come on, guys. Man up. Raise your hand. It's not that hard. And if you run for political office, there've got to be some things that you value enough to risk losing. If you don't run for office.
Do you miss it? Would you go back?
No. You know, 25 years in the jail cell was long enough. I enjoyed my time. I enjoyed it a lot. I never thought my wildest dreams I'd ever do anything like it. I have 11 brothers and sisters. My dad owned a bar. And like a lot of you, I worked my way through school, and I found myself in a small business that I bought and grew it into a successful business. And along the way, I got involved in my neighborhood homeowners association and ended up as Speaker of the House. This too could happen to you.
I think homeowners association boards probably are a little tougher than even the Congress.
I think you're right.
Governor, any regrets in terms of really a very long and illustrious career?
There are things that we didn't get done that I regret that we didn't get done. But I think we got done a great deal of things. One of the questions, he sent us the questions he was going to ask, although he hasn't asked us one question that he sent us. One of the questions he sent
us. That's why neither one of us read those questions very closely.
One of the questions was, what are the things that you're most proud of in your political career? And I remember when I became governor, President Bush was against raising the federal minimum wage. So I knew we had to raise it in Pennsylvania. And we raised it, I had a Republican House, Republican Senate, but we raised it $2 from $5.15 to $7.15. 70% of minimum wage workers were single moms with children. And that's, over the course of a year, a $4,000 raise. Now, a $4,000 raise doesn't make a whole lot of difference in the outcomes in our lives, but for somebody who was trying to feed a family of three on $10,200, a $4,000 raise was like manna from heaven. They could buy their kids some new clothes. They could have meat two or three times a week. They might even move to a decent apartment. Life-changing things. And I remember they arranged a signing ceremony in a church because so many members of the legislature wanted to be in on the ceremony. And people came just because they read it in the newspapers. And I thought as I signed that paper, I've just given 300,000 people $4,000 more a year to live on. And they're living at the lowest subsistence level. And that's why, if you ask me the same question as you asked John, even though there are very few John Boehners left in Harrisburg or Washington, people you could work with and get things done. That's why I miss it and I would go back, because nothing I've done in life since leaving government, even though I am now, I am embarrassed to say, in the 1%, nothing I have done gave me the feeling that I had that day. Nothing. And I would do it all over again, as tough as it is, and it's so much tougher now than when we started out, because the collegiality is gone. The ability to have, Bob Dole once told five mayors, and I was one of the five mayors, when the government was shut down in 94?
96.
96. Bob Dole said, if Bill Clinton and I got into a room alone, no staffers, no anybody, we'd have a budget in 2 hours. And that's probably right.
Well, he did finally go cut the deal.
Yeah, absolutely.
And cut us all out, yeah. Trust me, I'm well aware.
But I bet John and I could go through all of the tax expenditures and come up with terrific tax reform that will allow us to cut away at our debt and deficit and use some of that money to build a nation's infrastructure. We could do it, just because we're people who understand. You know, the irony of it is Donald Trump has that song with his campaign by the Rolling Stones, "You Can't Always Get What You Want." That should play in every cloakroom, bathroom, cafeteria in Washington. Because what's the second line of that song? You can't always get what you want, but if you try sometimes, you just might get what you need. And that's what we need, and we need people like John, and I know he's kidding that he'd go back in a minute, no. But we need people like John in the Congress. We need him in Harrisburg. We need him in Tallahassee. We need him in Albany. We've got to have people who are, you know, not worry about the next election, but worry about the next decade and the decade after that, and worry about our kids. And we got to find it somehow.
Well, that's what I hope. You jokingly said you're has-beens, and you may be, but you've got experience. You've got no immediate agenda. You can take that long view, and you just hope that those that are there are listening to the folks that have been there before and might have some insights that would be very beneficial for the future of this country.
You know, as Ed knows, 95% of the members of Congress, Democrats and Republicans, are really good, decent, honest people. You know, they may disagree on this issue and that issue, but they're there for the right reasons. Now, you know, the other 5%, we won't talk about them.
Well, I do appreciate the time you've taken out to be with us today. You've given us some great insights about what you experienced, and I think gave us some hope and optimism for the future. Thank you.
And if I would say one last thing, and I think John mentioned it in his remarks, you all should keep doing what you're doing. Keep innovating. Keep finding better ways to deliver quality care at a more affordable price tag, because someone's going to listen. Someone's going to listen. Eventually, we're going to listen, and we're going to get it right. But it'll depend on a lot of people, not just the people in Washington, but a lot of the people in this room.
Join me in thanking Secretary, Speaker Boehner, and Governor Rendell.
Thank you,
gentlemen. Thank you very much.
Good to be with you.